the main event as Hearts hosted Celtic. A tough week for the champions after their draw against AEK Athens and missing out on John McGinn to Aston Villa. Watching for us was Liam McLeod.
It's a first taste of this fixture for six of that Hearts starting 11. Smith comes into the side at right back. Lafferty starts, having scored three against Celtic last season. Athens and Brendan Rodgers' mind quite clearly, with Rogic and Chamage, Warr and Forrest all on the bench. There are 10 Celtic starts for Hayes and Kouassi. Here's Scott Sinclair. You're going to test Smith, who's back at his normal right back position. And Sinclair's wanting a penalty for handball. Will be the Celtic supporters up the other end of the school end of Tynecastle, appealing a lot louder than the Celtic number 11. Convincing victories for the sides in this fixture last season. Three for Celtic and, of course, memorably for Hearts, that 4-0 trouncing last December. It's not the worst ball in the world, and Naismith's wanting a penalty now up the other end. The challenge is from Simunovic, and Craig Levein is apoplectic about this. John Beaton not interested. Brown. Sinclair. Tierney as ever is an option. Lovely first time ball that, it really is, and Sinclair's put it across the face. Best bit of football in the game so far from the champions. Griffiths, first start of the season for him today, and it's his corner, and it's over from Brown. And there's eight of the Celtic starting 11 started the 4-0 loss here in December, looking to make amends. Celtic did exorcise some of the ghosts with a 3-1 win here in May. Griffiths. It's nice play from Griffiths! And but for Michael Smith, he'd have scored here again. That's a bit brighter from Griffiths, who will be eager to make the most of his game time. As half-time approaches, Celtic's best chance comes and goes. As you can see here, Christophe Berra in a bit of trouble here. In fact, he's going to have to be stretchered off by the looks of things. The Hearts captain, and that is a blow when you consider how good he was for the vast majority of last season. He had something to say to his team, you would imagine, over the course of this first half, Brendan Rodgers, because Celtic haven't really had as much control as they would like, and there's Stephen Naismith colliding with Johnny Hayes. It was Hayes' challenge initially. And here it was, coming together. Down went Hayes, Stephen Naismith having a little kick out at the Celtic number 15. Just one win over Celtic in 23 for Hearts. It was spectacular, to be fair to them. Poor ball by Lafferty. Scott Sinclair. That's a great ball for Griffiths! Spilled by the keeper, who recovers. Just. A check wearing the number one for Hearts. And Griffiths, again, it's on his weaker right foot. McGregor on the follow-up. Hendry. Celtic will be without the suspended Christopher Ayer for their trip to Athens in midweek. Champions League third qualifying round tie, 1-1, but they trail, I guess, on the away goal rule right now. Here's Iki Piatsu. It's a great little run from him as well. That's Lafferty! It's outstanding! He's at it again against the champions. Brilliant spade work by Kipiatsu initially. But what about that for a finish from Lafferty? And delight for Levein, delight for the Ulsterman. Christophe Berra there to watch it. It looks painful. We're hearing it's a hamstring problem. Smith's long throw. Hearts looking for a quick fire second, and Smith certainly fancies it. He has another pop, and suddenly Celtic are rattled. The real period of control Celtic had in this game was just before the Hearts goal. And that's what will frustrate Brendan Rodgers. But there's a yellow card issued to Stephen Naismith here. He ran into Simunovic, a bit of afters too. Sinclair to Tierney. Changing gears, but Michael Smith's done a good job today. McGregor, Sinclair. There's no easy way through. We saw Celtic toil against Athens during the week. It's Rogic! As close as they've come in the second half, really. And it's the sub Rogic. There's no more time. It's another famous Hearts victory over Celtic.
For us, obviously, we're disappointed. You know, the timing of the goal, because we started the second half well. But we give away the ball needlessly under no pressure. And then, obviously, they break through. And in fairness to Kyle Lafferty, finishes it very well. So we're then chasing the game. They're nice and compact, Hearts, and... And today we just couldn't break through that.
I think from the first minute to the 93rd, I think we'll probably see him Monday or Tuesday, the distance that the team covered, and it's probably been the highest out of the two seasons I've been here. But I think it's a proper team performance from Bobby to Uche, and even the players came on, they put a shift in. So I think that's what it takes to beat teams like Celtic, and obviously we'll look forward to next week.
And then after the game, Hearts cut the grass. Michael Stewart, you were there. Fantastic victory for Hearts. Deserved.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. Yeah. You know, obviously a lot's been made about Celtic resting players, but irrespective of that, you know, this was about Hearts' performance. They're the ones that dictated how the game went, yeah. And it was a massive, massive victory for the home side.
Well, that's it, Stephen. I mean, you know, how big a statement result was this from Craig Levein's side?
It's a huge statement. I mean, yeah. I thought they were excellent last weekend. We know their home record at Tynecastle is superb. But they worked ever so hard, they defended really well, they scored a brilliant goal, so they thoroughly deserved to win.
Michael, we've been debating whether it's Peter Haring or Peter Haring. I suppose the real debate is, why was this guy playing in the Austrian second division?
Well, he's certainly a fine, because you know, he's a guy who can play at the back or in the middle of the field, but you look at the ability to pass the ball at that's not a typical defensive type midfielder. But he had everything in the game yesterday, patrolled that area just in front of the back four, and he did things like this, you know, just picking up the ball and making sure when he was in their control, he was composed as well. There's a bit of pressure, just nicks it between the two, and then he sees the space out in the wider area. And this was right throughout the whole game, moment after moment, when Peter Haring was involved. It was an influential moment, and none more so than this, where Cal McGregor's about to get a strike on goal. Wonderful bit of defensive play to get the block on, and it goes out for the corner kick. Again here, you know, watch him here. He's the first one to react, gets the ball, tight, composed, moves it, shifts it, and plays it out wide. Absolutely fantastic performance from Peter Haring yesterday, and I think he got man of the match at the stadium, and quite rightly so. And it's an absolute mystery as to, you know, why he was playing in the second division in Austria.
And just for the record, for all the pedants out there, Peter Haring.
We're going for Haring, yes, Jonathan.
Let's stick with that. How much of a tactical triumph would you say this was for Craig Levein?
Well, I think that, you know, the big thing was that the Hearts set up to allow the two centre-halves on the ball, whereas, you know, we look at last season, they put them under real pressure. And this was early on in the game, and it looked as if they were going to do the same again, charging at Celtic, putting them under real pressure. But as the game wore on, the tactical shape and set-up from Hearts was a real success. You see here, locking on to the two midfielders was Ollie Lee and Stephen Naismith. And then big Ikpeazu in the centre-forward area was able to go man for man almost with the two centre-halves from Celtic and force them to play longer balls, because the Celtic centre-halves weren't wide enough. They're too narrow here, and it means that Ikpeazu can almost marshal the two of them. Again, you see Stephen Naismith up against Scott Brown, Ollie Lee up against Ebi Kouassi, and you see here when he's then forced to go longer, that's not the way that Celtic want to play.
Yeah.
They want to play short, neat passes, but Hearts forced them into a style of game that they weren't comfortable with, and you know, ultimately it led to Kouassi having a very, very poor game. Mm-hmm. It you know, ended up with him getting substituted
well,
as well.
Let's talk about the Celtic personnel, and we'll get on to John McGinn later as well, but you feel reinforcements are required. In which positions in particular?
Well, when you look at the, you know, the Celtic team, when they're stretched, and they've obviously had a number of players rested for this big game in Athens, and you have Kouassi coming in here, he didn't have a successful afternoon here. Number of incidents here, you know, not under any real pressure as this ball comes back to him, miscontrolled. Mulroney snaps in and gets and wins the ball.
His reaction's poor as well.
And, yeah, you're right. I mean, look at his reaction here as he looks to play that longer ball again, forcing it. And you can see the frustration here. He's disappointed with himself because it was not a good afternoon. And Šimunović at centre-half allows it to bounce. You cannot do that with Ikpeazu. He's just going to bully you. Naismith gets a fantastic strike off. But as the game wore on, Šimunović is not speaking to Scott Brown there. He needs to come in, talk to his captain. He comes and wins the ball easy enough. The atmosphere at Tynecastle can be intimidating for some players, and it looked as if Kouassi and Šimunović in particular started to crumble. Again, no pressure.
Yeah.
Giving the ball away.
These are going to have to be the centre-halves that play in Athens.
Exactly.
Because Dyer suspended.
Yep.
Boyata.
All sorts happening with Boyata.
And you hear Brendan Rodgers talking about no pressure. This is the goal. Watch Kyle Lafferty in the top of the screen where he makes his run from originally. But Šimunović gives the ball away under no pressure. And then here, look at the defending from Jack Hendry. His body position is all completely wrong. He's trying to show him infield. You want to show him down the line here, and if his body position is the opposite way, he would be able to win that. But take nothing away from Kyle Lafferty, because that is a sensational finish.
Techniques,
absolutely.
It really is a
brilliant victory for Hearts, but there we have it. We can see on the screen there, John McGinn and Brendan Rodgers. How difficult a week has this been for Celtic?
It's been a very difficult week, Jonathan. And the thing that's probably most frustrating for that man there, Brendan Rodgers, is a lot of it's self-inflicted. You know, you see John McGinn there. That deal should have been done weeks ago, and nobody will convince me that John McGinn wouldn't have stepped into that Celtic team and made a big difference yesterday. The whole debate about John McGinn, would he start for Celtic? Celtic have got so many games that they need a bigger squad. They've lost Stuart Armstrong, they've lost Patrick Roberts, and they've not replaced. The squad is weaker now, and these sorts of deals like John McGinn would have strengthened Celtic, and they should have got
squads
that done.
Squads need to evolve as well. You need to have a freshness. When you sign a new player and you come into the changing room, yeah, it keeps everybody on their toes. It just seems that they've been so reactive rather than proactive in the transfer market, and it's a dangerous game to play.
And John McGinn would have been the perfect player for that match yesterday. Stephen, I mean, it's been unadulterated success for Brendan Rodgers since he arrived at Celtic. The Celtic brand was so strong not that long ago. Suddenly, I mean, how serious do you feel that these cracks are that we're starting to see?
I don't know if they're that serious, but it's the first time that we've seen cracks since he came to Scotland. Everything has been an absolute honeymoon for him.
Yeah.
Everything's gone perfectly for him and the club. And this is the first time there has been a slight bit of disruption. I suppose you could look at the European result. I mean, that's hanging in the balance. You've got losing the game yesterday, losing out on McGinn. The Boyata stuff's very unclear. You know,
bizarre.
He seems very unhappy with his position at the club just now. So there are small cracks appearing.
The thing is, Jonathan, you know, that game at Tynecastle, that sums it up perfectly. Your squad's stretched. You can't go to places like Tynecastle with a stretched squad and you're dropping, you know, or you're resting five or six players, and you're going to come up against, you know, Hearts, Hibs, Aberdeen away from home. These are all difficult games, and you need a strong squad to be able to cope with those games as well as Europe.
And I think it's also amplified by what's going on over the road at Rangers.
Absolutely.
You know, things are looking bright and positive.
But yesterday, it really is. It's a success story for Hearts rather than the negatives of Celtic.
Tough night for Celtic coming up on Tuesday against Athens. We wish them well. Hibernians' European adventure also in the balance after their 0-0 draw midweek with Molde. Neil Lennon's side winners last